Good evening, everyone. I was sitting on the front row and I thought, I hope you can see the screen with the stands there. I couldn't see, but I'm on the front row, but you can see the screen, right? Because I'm going to teach you a song, and I think they have a table for me too. So they were going to move all of these stands if they sang first, but they're not. So we're going to try to make our way around some of these different obstacles here. But we'll try to do that without spilling our water. There we go. I am very excited to come back from Australia. And I'm going to move this a little bit too, if I can. Otherwise, you know, I'm so short. If I stand behind a plant, you can't see me. I just came back from Australia. Tonight, they're starting 27 evangelistic meetings in the city of Sydney. They've got programs in English, Chinese, Arabic, Portuguese, Samoan, Tongan. So if you would join with us this weekend, they have over 5,000 that have already registered to attend the meetings. I just want to know if it was okay to say amen in Arden. You know, it's a battle, isn't it? It's a great controversy. And you know how distracting it is to live in a secular society because you experience it yourself. So here, 5,000 people have signed up to go to these different locations, and including an Arabic location, an Iraqi pastor. There's a fairly sizable Arabic population in Sydney. And so there are going to be meetings in Arabic too. So Sydney, the series citywide is called The Last Empire. So I think you can probably go to thelastempire.com.au or something and look at that website. But just really excited to bring that news to you and just pray for what God's doing in Sydney. It's kind of a counterpart to what's happening in New York, New York 13, which is happening here. And each division is choosing a city. And then from that, each union will choose a city until we'll have over 600 cities with that. We need to reach the cities of our world. Half of the population of the world doesn't live in rural North Carolina. They wish they did, but they don't. They live in the cities. And so we've got a mission there. So if you join with us in prayer for that. Thank you for inviting me to be here. As Dr. Butcher said, I was flat on my back on Wednesday. And I prayed a simple prayer. I said, God, you know, I'm filming on Sunday for Hope Sabbath School. Monday, we'll be filming October, November, and December, these next two weekends. And I said, you know what needs to happen if I'm going to be at Arden Church this weekend. I need a dramatic improvement in my health in 24 hours. It was not a demand. It was just saying, God, you know. And as I stand here tonight, all I can say, as I shared with Dr. Butcher, is that I believe God has something special for us this weekend. So if you can pray for strength for me and hearing hearts for all of us, I know God's going to bless. So will you pray with me, please? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this precious group tonight. People could be doing a lot of other things, but you've brought us together here to speak to our hearts. And I just pray that you would draw near to us and bless each one. And we thank you in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I'm going to start by teaching you a song. So that's why I wanted to make sure that you could see the screen. And, you know, I don't sing that well. When God said, you want to sing up front, I said, do I have to sing up front? And the Spirit rebuked me and said, you still don't get it, do you? It's not about you, it's about me. So I'm going to teach you a song, and I heard some amazing voices. Heather, where are you? And your clan, Sean, and everybody else, if I can remember all of your names. I said, please sing. So let's see if we can sing it together. Can we put it a little louder? Here's how it goes.
The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few, the laborers are few.
play louder.
The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest, into his harvest. The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few.
That was Luke 10 and verse 2. John 4.
Do you not say there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for the harvest.
All right, you've heard it. Now let's try to sing it together.
The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. The laborers are few. The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few.
Therefore pray.
Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers.
Therefore pray.
Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers.
You sounded good. You know, I love mountains. I was checking to see the highest mountain in North Carolina. Is it Mount Mitchell? Okay. So I was just checking what the highest mountain in Samoa was, because I was talking to Samoans last week, and I grew up in a fairly flat island. At least the part of England that I lived was pretty flat. So I remember when I first went to the place where my mother's family was from, Switzerland. Anybody been to Switzerland? Well, my mother's family was from the Bernese Oberland, from Interlaken, if any of you have been there. Isn't that a beautiful part of the world? So I went over to Interlaken, and if you've ever been there, you can get a train pass, but it's a pass for all of the cable cars and the cog railways. And I took this cog railway up the Jungfrau. Did you go there? To Jungfraujoch? It's that kind of yoke between the two mountains. And then there's this structure. Oh, the screen's going down. I wonder what it was, the end of the world or something. There's this structure on the top of this, you know, you're now at about 13,000 feet, and it's called the Sphinx. Has anyone been to the Sphinx? No. Okay. You have to Google it when you get home. It's an observation tower, and from the Sphinx, you can look out and see the top of the Swiss Alps. Unbelievable view. Now, have you seen a view comparable to that somewhere? Some of you may have been to out to Mammoth in California or somewhere. Have you ever been somewhere where you, on the British Columbia? Yeah, like in the Canadian Rockies or something? Well, this is amazing. When I went up there from living on a little flat island to looking at the top of the world, it seemed like to me, I was seeing the world from a totally new perspective. And that's what I want to talk to you about tonight. We're talking about God's plan for our lives. And I want to challenge you this weekend with the thought that God wants to use you to change the world. Does that sound radical to you? You thought you were just here to make a living and try to stay out of trouble till Jesus comes, right? But that's not why you're here. You are here, sir. You are here, my sister, because God wants to use you to change the world. Now, not all the world will want to be changed. I know that. But some will. Some will. In order to catch a vision of God's amazing plan, whether you are in a profession or a trade or a full-time homemaker, whatever you're doing, God wants to use you in your sphere of influence to change your world. In order to believe that, you have to start seeing the world from God's radical perspective. I have discovered that on my own, I do not see the world as God does. But I'm going to challenge us in part one of this three-part series. And by the way, if you had to miss any of the three, you should have missed tonight, okay? Because tomorrow, and especially tomorrow afternoon, so is there enough fellowship meal for everybody to stay? Okay, you can't miss tomorrow afternoon. It is crucially important. But you can't even really comprehend tomorrow morning and afternoon without tonight. So some people might be saying, I don't know, this seems so amazing. And you say, well, you've got to first see the world from God's radical perspective. You see, you got to get up above just living on a little flat space, and you've got to see the big picture as God does. And Jesus gives us a window into God's radical perspective in a passage of Scripture I've been studying for the past 14 years, and I keep learning more things even now. So either I'm a very slow learner, or the Bible is very deep, or both. But I'm still in Luke chapter 10, and I'm actually just going to take you to five words this evening. And, you know, I could actually have a quiz. I did this at the Samoan church in Sydney. I had a quiz. People left. They had to give me the five words in order to get out, to go home. So, I don't know. You may want to pay attention so that you can go home tonight. Luke chapter 10. This is really important. And I have to remind myself of this. My wife asks me sometimes, don't you get bored? You know, because you go places, you don't always share the different things. When I was at Forest Lake Church, I'm preaching a different sermon every week. And I say, no, because I need to hear it. I need to really believe this. It's really important. Look with me in Luke chapter 10 if you have a Bible. If you didn't bring your Bible, bring it tomorrow, unless, of course, you've memorized it already. Luke chapter 10 and verse 2. Jesus said to them. Look in the context, help me. Who is the them? The 70. Thank you. Who are the 70? They're followers, disciples. That's right. He has sent out the 12 and actually said exactly the same thing to them as he's about to say to the 70. But he tells them just to go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now he's sending out the 70, which is a significant number because in Genesis 10, 70 is the list of all of the descendants of Noah. So it represents the whole planet. So he's sending them out. They're going to go every village and town he's about to go. So these are his followers. And Jesus says to them. Now I want to suggest he's also talking to us. How do I know that? Because Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. He says, I'm going to be with you always, even until... Okay, so just not for the 70, right? It's until the what? Till the end of the age. So Jesus says to them, and also to us, here's the five words you need to go home tonight, all right? You've got it in your Bible. I'm quoting from the New King James Version. Jesus says to them, the harvest truly is great. You say, well, that's the song we just sang. That's right. That was the scripture reading. We're going to sing that during the weekend so you'll remember it. The harvest truly is great. There's five words. I want you to say them with me. The harvest truly is great. Can you remember that? Let's do it one more time. The harvest truly is great. Now, you're saying, I had supper with the Collins family, and Noah shared some amazing stuff he's learning in his Bible challenge. that's awesome, you know, because it's going to stay with him. I want these five words to stay with you. This is not words I made up. Who said these? Jesus said them. So these words have eternal significance. Amen? Five words. What are they again? So you can forget my name. You can forget, you know, a lot of things I say. You can forget my relatives came from the Bernese Oberland. You can forget all of that, but you got to remember five words. What are they? Okay, now in order for this to make sense, you have to understand what Jesus is talking about. So the harvest, the metaphor of the harvest, is used in two ways in the New Testament. Okay? It's used in reference to the end of the age. You remember Jesus told a story about some people who came and sowed weeds in a field? All right? And it said, an enemy, it's Matthew 13, an enemy has done this. Okay? Should we pull it up? No. Wait until the end. Let me read it to you in Matthew chapter 13. You can keep your place in Luke 10. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 13, an enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age. The harvest is what? The end of the age. And the reapers are the angels. Okay, so one use of the metaphor of the harvest in the Bible is the end of the age. And who are the reapers? Now, if you read right after the three angels' messages in Revelation 14, it talks again about the harvest. But then, you know who the reaper is in Revelation 14? It's right. It's the one who sits on the throne. Put in your sickle, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. So if you read the New Testament, and by the way, I hope you're reading your Bible. If you aren't, you will be led astray. Satan seeks every possible device, great controversy, to engross the mind. Those who neglect prayer and a study of the Bible will be led astray. Page 519. I thought that was pretty significant because I don't want to be led astray. Do you? So we want to be reading our Bibles. I was so encouraged at supper, you know, and a little child shall lead us, right? Praise God for Bible challenge. Reading my Bible, and I'm finding the metaphor of the harvest can refer to the end of the age, and the harvesters are the angels and the one who sits on the throne, right? But the metaphor of the harvest is also a present activity because Jesus sends out the 70 and he says to them, not talking about the judgment at the end of the world, he's talking about a present harvest and who are the reapers for that present harvest? The 70 and, because he's talking to us too, right? And Jesus says about the present harvest, what? Okay, so we're the reapers, and what's the harvest? That's right, men and women, boys and girls, just waiting for the invitation. Now, I know sometimes I struggle. I think nobody's interested, right? Nobody's interested. You're wrong. I'm sorry. Sometimes I may agree with you, and then I'm wrong too. Nobody's interested. We're wrong. What did Jesus say? I was speaking in Stockholm this December. A group of 415 young adults came for Impact Scandinavia in a secular part of the world. Young leaders on fire for God. The bus driver, his name was Jan, he said 6 months ago, I was an evolutionary atheist. Today, he's a devoted follower of Jesus. I'm like, wow, what happened? He said, well, I was studying about horticulture and green science and solar stuff. And I went to this place and there were some Seventh-day Adventist people there. And they told me about Jesus and about the Bible. And now he's at a mission school in Norway, devoting his life to telling people about Jesus. God help me to see as you do. You say, well, that was there. That's not North Carolina. God, help me to see as you do. The harvest truly is great. Now, why does Jesus, he's about to send the 70 out, and he wants to send us out, why does he tell us the harvest truly is great? Why does he tell us that? Okay, That's exactly right. Because it is, okay? So Jesus is speaking the truth. That's why he says it. But I want to suggest to you, sometimes that's obvious, but most of the time it's not obvious to us. Sometimes it's obvious. Day of Pentecost, obvious, right? You know, other times, Athens, Paul speaks, just a little handful of people. So here we are, Pentecost. Peter preaches in the power of the Holy Spirit, the other apostles preach. Spirit of God sweeps across the crowd. Someone interrupts his sermon. You can interrupt my sermon tonight, as long as you say something profound. You know? They interrupted his sermon. He wasn't even done with his sermon. You say, Derek, how do you know that? Because it says, with this and many other words, he continued to exhort them. He wasn't even done. He's talking about Jesus, the Savior, that God has sent. And someone cries out, brothers, what shall we do? Moving of the Spirit of God. Brothers, what shall we do? And Peter does not say, would you please wait until I'm finished with my sermon? He cries back, repent and be baptized for the remission of your sins. The promise is for you and for your children. Repent. You know what the word repent means? It's a change of mind, a change of heart. It's a turning. It's like you're heading to destruction. And by a miracle of God, even in this state of North Carolina, even in the city where you work, maybe even in the family that you're a part of, God is going to turn lives around. What did Jesus say? I imagine when they said, how many responded when he cried out, repent? 3,000 people responded to the invitation. Now, how large was the church before the day of Pentecost? 120 in the upper room, right? Give or take a few. So one Sabbath, they've got 120. Next Sabbath, they have 3,120. Give or take a few. I don't know what... we have several churches here, right? Several churches. Arden, how many Arden members are here? Okay. Got any Fletcher members here? All right. And Miles, what's the... Mills River here, okay. So, Hendersonville, all right. Any others? All right, so we got several here. So, I don't know how many members at Mills River. 100, okay. So, Mills River, any of you been to Mills River Church? Okay. This week, 100. Next week, 3,100. We're going to look at each other and say, you know what? The words of Jesus were true. Sometimes that's obvious. I was reading an email this last week about a baptism in the South American division. Now, some of you might say, well, it's easy in the South American division. Listen, there is secular down there. There is challenge there. Satan's working as hard down there. Whenever you see a great harvest, you ought to use my favorite Hebrew word. You know what my favorite Hebrew word is? Hallelujah. You know what hallelujah means? Praise the Lord. That's a Hebrew word, okay? So don't just say, well, that's New Guinea. Listen, New Guinea is a war zone. People come to Christ there. We ought to say what? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I'm reading a report from the South American Division, March 24. I remember the day because it's my father's birthday. March 24, one Sabbath, 45,000 people were baptized. Across the division, and I read the testimony, Christina, from one site. She said, I was without hope, and now I found Jesus. And I'm paraphrasing here. She said, I was without hope, I found Jesus. My life has a new direction. She was one of 1,400 people baptized at her location. When you see things like that, I mean, it's pretty obvious that what Jesus said is true. What did Jesus say? So he said it because it's true. He said it knowing that sometimes it's obvious. But I want to suggest to you that most of the time, it is not obvious to us. If you're looking from a human perspective, most of the time, it's not obvious. It happened in the ministry of Jesus. You quoted an instance. Jesus, it says at the beginning of John 4, and sometimes we read the Bible too quickly and we miss things. It says Jesus needed to go through Samaria. Now you go, oh, that's interesting. Like, I need to go to Asheville. No, you don't understand. The Jews didn't go through Samaria. They went around. Remember your geography? I guess I'm doing it backwards. They went across the Jordan, through Perea, and up into Galilee. They didn't want to go through Samaria. They hated the Samaritans. Those half-breeds, those pagan mixed people. But Jesus needed to go through Samaria. Are you glad that we have a Savior that's willing to go anywhere? Maybe some places we wouldn't go. Yeah. He needed to go through Samaria. So Jesus decides to hold an evangelistic meeting just outside of Sychar. And you know how many people showed up? Now, Dr. Butcher said to me, we're not too many. I think we have a pretty good group here tonight. But, you know, you'd be pretty discouraged if it was just you and me, right? You're like, how's the group? It's lean tonight. Just one. Now, the disciples, follow me. This is really important. The disciples look at that one person and they say, no harvest here. In fact, God forgive us. The disciples look at the whole city and they say the whole city can be damned. Let's just try to stay out of trouble until Jesus comes. Huh? Or do we believe what Jesus said? What did Jesus say? They look at this woman, they go, no harvest here, let's go to Taco Bell, get some food. And they walk off. But Jesus looks at this one person, and what does he say? I know it's not in the text, but I know that's what he said. Because he's looking from a divine perspective, a radical perspective. He looks beyond what the human eye sees. The harvest truly is great. Now get this. He talks to this lady. Have you read the story in John chapter 4? Yes. Maybe not all of us have read the Bible, so that's okay. John chapter 4, he meets this lady at a well, and they have a conversation. And she doesn't have a very good reputation, right? You know, I mean, she's been around a lot. But she's one of the few people that Jesus directly reveals his identity to. She says, well, when the Messiah comes, he will show us all things. And Jesus says to her, I am he. You see, when you look on the outside, you might go, no harvest here. But Jesus says, he sees her heart. We judge people. We discard people. We go, those people are losers. They're not going to make it. And Jesus says, some of them will enter the kingdom of heaven ahead of you. I am he. And she's like, whoa. She believes him. So she's like, I'm going to go back to the city. So she goes back to Sychar. You read the text in John 4. And maybe didn't notice. So she calls all the men of the city. She knew them all. And she startled them by saying, come, meet a man who told me everything I ever did. And they're like, but she doesn't judge them. She just says, could this be the Christ? John chapter 4. The men, maybe women and children too, come streaming out of the city. They're coming not to get water, but living water. The disciples are coming back from Taco Bell, and they still don't see. God help us. Something special is going to happen this weekend. I pray. I need a miracle on a daily basis. I want to see the world as God does. They still don't see. And Jesus rebukes them. He says to them, we sang it in our scripture song. He says to them, do you not say 4 months? And then comes the harvest? Maybe. Maybe. Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already. Now, I always thought that was just like an illustration, like an agricultural illustration. I don't think that anymore. I'm like, look at the fields. What's out in the fields? The people are streaming out, and the disciples don't even see them. We're just trying to stay out of trouble till Jesus comes. And Jesus says, look. God, open our eyes to see as you do. Would you pray for that for me? Would you? I need that. Sometimes I go through a big secular city, I'm like, all of their sophistication, all of their I don't see the brokenness of their hearts and the emptiness of their relation. I don't see that. It looks pretty good to me. I don't see that longing for something more. I need to see as God sees. The harvest truly is great. We were holding evangelistic meetings in Allentown, Pennsylvania. And not too many people came. I mean, not even the church members. Does that ever happen here? You have a meeting and not even the church members come? Not here? Okay. Like there really didn't, not many people came. But there was this one young couple. John, they were sitting right about where you are, right, row 3. Young couple in their 20s, and they were really listening to the presentation. How can you tell if someone's really interested? They're looking at you. What else? They're smiling, nodding. They had their Bible. When we talked about a text, they'd open their Bible, and they were kind of learning to find their way. You know what I'm talking about? Like, not... No, I know you've had a long week. Stay with me. Got a few more minutes. And they're like really interested, you know? And I'm like, okay, well, maybe there's not going to be a great harvest, but maybe there'll be a little harvest on row 3. God, forgive me. Help me to see as you do. God looks, and what does he say? Well, they're sitting on row 3. We get to the end of the meetings. I think, well, I better go. I'm just a young pastor. I don't know very much. So I think I better go visit them. So I go to visit them, and I'm like, thank you so much for coming to the meetings and just really been encouraged by seeing, you know, yours. And I just want to invite you to be baptized and become part of this last day movement, preparing the world for the coming of Jesus. And they said, well, Pastor, thank you. We've really enjoyed the meetings, but we don't feel convicted that we should be baptized and become part of the church. And I felt like someone took a pin and went, and burst my bubble. Crop failure. I mean, I was hoping for this little harvest, right? And I thought, now what shall I do? And then I had an amazing idea. Maybe I should pray. Why do we wait till the end to pray? We ought to pray at the beginning. And like all the way through, right? Because if we're looking from a human perspective, we might just go off and get some lunch. But if somehow a miracle of God could happen and we could begin to see the world as God does, what could happen? What could God do through you in your profession, in your business, in your... What could God do to change the world through you if you would see the world as He does? I thought maybe I should pray. He can. So I start praying for Gary and Lori. And I'm praying for them. Thursday, I'm praying for them. God, I don't know what to do, but I just see Your Spirit's been touching their hearts. I just want to pray for them. Gary worked Thursday night. He worked the night shift at a factory in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Got off early Friday morning, got in his car. For any of you that know Pennsylvania, took the northeast extension of the Pennsylvania Turnpike up to Allentown. He's on his way home from Philadelphia to Allentown, and on the highway, he comes under the overwhelming conviction of the Holy Spirit. I love it when God does that. You believe God can still work miracles today?
Yes.
If you don't, let's all go home. Skip tomorrow. Our God is an awesome God. He's a miracle-working God. This guy's driving on the highway, comes under the overwhelming conviction of the Holy Spirit that he should be baptized and become a member of this last day movement, preparing the world for the coming of Jesus. But he says to himself, how am I going to tell my wife? What he didn't understand at the time is that Jesus said, it's actually good if I go away. Now that same doesn't make sense to me either, unless I read the context, because he says, I will pray the Father, and he will send you another comforter who will be with you and in you. You see, what Gary didn't yet understand is that the Holy Spirit could visit a speeding car on a highway between Philadelphia and Allentown, and the Holy Spirit could also visit a house in Allentown. You know where I'm going with the story, don't you? The Holy Spirit could also visit a house in Allentown, Pennsylvania, where Lori is beginning her day and comes under the overwhelming conviction of the Holy Spirit that she should be baptized and become a part of this last day movement, preparing for the soon coming of Jesus. But she said, how am I going to tell my husband? And then Gary got home, and Lori and Gary shared together and rejoiced in the Lord. This is Friday morning, right? I've been praying because I didn't know what to do. Sabbath morning, they come to church, and they're sitting on row three, smiling just like always, you know, and they're turning in their Bibles and looking at the text. And I go to the back door after the service, and Gary walks up to me with Lori by his side and says, Pastor, we would like to be baptized and become members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I almost said, why? What happened? I didn't say that. Fortunately, you don't always say what you think, right? You have to kind of think before you say. So I'm like, hopefully. I'm like, what? See, I didn't know what had happened, did I? We'd like to be baptized. And I'm like, praise God. And then they shared this story, and I'm like, whoa. Thank you, God. By the way, whose harvest is it? Not your harvest. It's not my harvest. It's His harvest, right? So, I mean, He's allowed to work as many miracles as He wants. Amen? He wants us to join Him. We're going to talk about that tomorrow. He wants us to join Him, but first, we have to see that there's a harvest at all and believe what Jesus said. You say, well, that's really a nice story, Derek. I mean, two people were baptized in the meetings. That's nice. Not a big harvest. God, help me to see as You do. We're standing in the baptistry a few months later after preparing Gary and Lori for baptism. And Gary says to me, Pastor, can I say a few words to the church? I said, certainly. His wife had cystic fibrosis. She'd been dying since she was little. She treated herself 6 hours a day with percussion instruments to get all of this mucus that would continue to fill her lungs. She's drowning. He stands up. His wife has this chronic illness. He knew that the church, some had heard, and some were, oh, wouldn't it be wonderful if maybe this could be taken away? By the way, I believe God could have taken that away. I've seen miracles of healing. I believe that God can work miracles, but I know that He doesn't always take away those ailments, but He gives us something more. And Gary's standing there, and he says, I just want to say something to you today. He said, some people live for 70 years. Lori is going to live forever. And as he spoke, my brother, the Spirit spoke to me and said that that young man, that factory worker from Philadelphia, is going to be a preacher. 2-year associate's degree working at a factory where they made catalytic converters. You know what a catalytic converter does? It converts the... Yeah. But God says, no, I'm going to take him to convert something else. That factory worker. He's going to be a preacher. Several years later, Gary graduated as the outstanding preacher of his senior class at Southern Adventist University. Today, he's the vice president of your conference, Gary Moyer. Thousands of people have heard about Jesus because of his testimony. His wife, Lori, finally her lungs began to fail. No more medication worked. Gary offered to give one of his lungs, but Lori was too weak, and she fell asleep in Jesus. But she will not stay in the grave. The day will come when the Master will call. Awake, you who sleep in the dust, and arise. And Lori, who listened to her Savior while she was living, will hear his voice and come forth. And there's going to be a whole lot of celebration on that day. You'll probably be surprised to see me there. You'll say, Derek, how did you get here? And I will tell you the same way that you did, by the grace of God. We're going to see some people that we didn't expect to be there. They're going to have all kinds of body piercings and tattoos and, you know, some unsavory looking people that were saved. People with a bad reputation who just met Jesus. And their life was changed. Would you pray with me tonight that God would help us to see the world as He does? That we wouldn't be affected by our culture, but that we would have the heart of God and see with His eyes. If you're willing to pray that with me tonight, then we're ready to talk about something tomorrow that God could do in you and through you to change the world. So what are we going to do? Do we just say it was a nice meeting? Or is there someone here be willing to stand up and say, God, I'm just by standing saying, I want you to help me to see the world as you do. Is there anybody? There's someone back there, someone here, some young people here, praise God. Yeah, I mean, you don't have to stand, you know. You could say, no, I'm just trying to stay out of trouble. Till Jesus comes, you know. When God wants to use us to change the world in our circle of influence, you say, what's going to happen to me? I have no idea. Right, Ken? If I had an idea, I'd still be teaching at Southern Adventist University. I love that place. They call it Happy Valley. I mean, people who go there, like me teaching there, they stay there until they retire. They even have a cemetery there so you can wait until Jesus comes. Right there. But God wants to use you. And I don't know what it will mean. But I don't just yeah, I don't want to just live an average life. I want to live a life that makes a difference. Is that where you're standing tonight? God, help me to see the world as you do. God, see these precious people. Came out at the end of a busy week. You hear my prayer. You hear their prayers. God, we want to be courageous enough to say, whatever the cost, whatever the cost, open our eyes to see the world as you do, and to believe deep in our hearts that the words of Jesus are true, that the harvest truly is great. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Be seated.